three, four.
Also, our guests that are attending this talk also from through the internet can join in. So welcome. Also, we know that there are people watching from the distance. If you want to give feedback from the distance, please use the hashtag. Please use Twitter and hashtag EIT Helsinki, and so that we can get questions. Leo will give a presentation of roughly about a half an hour, and then there's room for discussion. But then you are actually quite in a hurry around 1 o'clock. Was that so?
Or even before.
So okay, let's try to be then concise. Thanks, okay. And let's give a hand to Leo.
Okay, thank you very much. It's nice to see you all here, and it's nice to see you all on the internet as well. So I'm going to talk about something which is very hype today. So it is about deep learning, and there are some kind of basics. So if after my talk you should have a certain type of a feeling about what it is and how it is used and what are the kind of the latest trends about it and how it is done. First I start with about things that matter. Of course, it is easy to talk about that. So looking at what I would define as modern machine learning, and show some recent progress on those items, and then perhaps even show a little what we have ourselves done on the topic. So just as a little sugar on the top. Coming from Nokia, it's always good to be able to talk something about mobile phones. And of course, this is something from mobile phones from 1983. So it is this kind of a thing what they say, that just take a small and handy phone anywhere you'd like to. And it is the Finnish kind of a slogan that one is using to sell it, is otat pienen ja kätevän puhelimen minne vain mukaasi. And if you are looking at the device, it's not that small and it's not handy so at all. So what it is on the real life is totally different. So it's about 4.5 kilograms, and it is actually not... It's trackable rather than portable, so or even nice. But what is essential here, I think, is that there is an idea that if you really want to have something important, it is this having a small and handy on your pocket and that you can bring anywhere. And actually, it got realized after 10 or 15 years, after this kind of an idea of starting doing that. And then after 30 years, it's a community, and there's time for Nokia to do something else. And now the question is about what would be the something else that we go on. I guess one of the ideas is that what would happen, and it is also in the same way in infancy, it's about this kind of bring machine intelligence to everyday life. So this is something that I believe that is going to make the same type of transformation that we did it with a mobile phone at circumstance. And what kind of examples it would be? So I like this kind of an idea about what would be the traffic of the tomorrow look like. So this is an intersection done by a simulation done by Austin, University of Texas Austin, and it is showing how cars are acting at an intersection when they know what they do. So just blasting through in a nice way, and you don't have to have traffic lights or anything like that. But of course, then somebody has already invented it. If you really look at around, think this is my favorite image apart from India, so that you're already having exactly the same. There is a bit difference here, though. So this has a different scale. So these cars are going fast, and these are going at a human scale. And I come back to the kind of same idea that changes the scales on systems a little. So the idea here is that how we can bring this programmable world around. It's about this kind of having URLs for every object. It is about machine vision on the thinking how to build robots that see around. It is about making self-driving cars. It may be that tomorrow or in the future you are not allowed to drive a car anymore because it's so dangerous if you are driving it. So in the things, it's about this kind of intelligent electric grids, about smart traffic, and I guess it's about things that when we gather all this information like this, it's not enough to just gather it for decision. I think it's about making the decisions automatically as well. So it is about using the perception to something that you have. And also, if we have this kind of machine vision going around and we use this one, it's not only about seeing what we see, it is actually seeing something else as well. So this is now what you can do with computer things that actually see much accurately than we do. So on those cases. So this research is for MIT that they are these subtle changes in the image that show when you press something and you can make it visible. on the type of an I do. So there is something that is around here, which is on this inhuman aspect of technology that we can bring in. And it actually started already 300 years ago. And it was this machine. This is my favorite example about the start of the Industrial Revolution. And it has this little centripetal valve here. When it rotates, it actually tunes the water pressure. The pressure of the water vapor in the system that makes the movement consistent. There is no human that can tune the valve to make this work. So that's why even if the Greeks invented the machine itself, they could never use it in any sensible way. The idea was to make something that can make decisions faster than human can. So that was the start of the Industrial Revolution. So, and of course we are using it on many cases. So a bicycle is something like that. It is also making decisions faster than we can. Because you cannot really keep it in balance by actuations that are not coming from the system of the steer wheel. And the balancing that is automatic on the system. And of course, this kind of aeroplanes with fly-by-wire are exactly using the same kind of an idea. So, but I would, this is an idea which is on also the coming that the scale of human decisions is now changing on the system. That if you do something, for example, you tweet, it takes 3 seconds. So if I get a response for you guys from the other sites, it's about 3 seconds that you tweet a nice tweet around and get it through. But if you really go on under this 1 second range, there is no way of human decisions making anymore that can handle the system. And there are some, again, if you go to down, I guess some of the fastest hardware that we're using are working on nanoseconds. Some of the high frequency trading is using some couple of milliseconds already on the system. So it creates this kind of a human decision ecosystem that we have already made in certain system in our society, but there's another ecosystem which is about this algorithmical ecosystem that is coming afterwards. And that's the place where I would say this machine learning is becoming very crucial on how to act in the sense. It is changing the way that the kind of the timeline of the unit of the system that we are working with. So I could kind of claim that this machine learning has become a pervasive technology that it underlying very many of these modern things that we are doing. It's a little similar than 20 years ago we found DSP. So it was something that you take digitization, you don't use analog processing anymore, you use digital system, you use DSP in different things, and it changes everything in after those words. Now this is coming and doing exactly the kind of thing. The same type of a thing, and I would say that one of the hottest areas on this are these deep neural networks, and they take inspiration for biology. If you're looking around here in the image, you said it has multiple layers, and it is a deep network. And of course, everybody has known that for 40 years already on the thinking. So now the question is that why we didn't do it that 40 years ago. So this is the kind of a question on thinking. If you just look at the thing, I guess the neural networks are very simple. So in the kind of things, why we just did not use it before? And when one is using it a decade ago, even still, they didn't seem to work at all. So one could not actually train them in any sensible ways, and you could not get them work at all. So what happened in actually making this jump from the thing? And there are some kind of pioneers on the area, and one of them was George Hinton. And he actually has told about where he found this idea was that he was looking at this kind of how eye is behaving, so how eye is working, and he was looking how when one is dissecting a cat's eye, and what is happening in the training of the cat. So when it sees to learns to see, they kind of check that they. This guy, this biologist Colin Blackmore, discovered that visual cortex develops in stages, tweaking in its connection response in sensory data one layer at a time, starting with the retina. So what happened in the training is that you train the deep layer network by layer, and that's how cat eye does it in biology. And then he took that idea about trying to make it so that, okay, don't try to learn the deep neural network one step of the time, I try to do it layer-wise. And this was one of the basic ideas that actually made the deep learning neural network to work, and one could actually get stable results out of it, and it became trainable on the system. Okay, so now there's always hype about what the kind of machine can do, and I guess already one can now ask about the machine that what does a computer think about us? So this is some of the latest results from that kind of sense. And we can see pictures of things. There is, for example, a nice, this is already a famous picture on the sense, because the, this Google system on the on the how they do it is saying that there is a group of young people playing a game of frisbee on that image. And this is exactly what you would say. So the computer is still thinking about that. And here is a herd of elephants walking across a dry grass field. Already a kind of a nice perception of the thing. You give it an image and you ask about what it does. And this is done by something which I will talk later is a combination of a convolutional neural networks and recurrent neural networks on how to then make the actual title on it. But if you then continue a little, so this is a kind of good example, one is always showing. Of course, the computer also thinks that there's two dogs playing in the grass here. So maybe we start kind of, we have to start learning the arithmetic as well at a certain stage, because I think they are three dogs. So there is a close-up of a cat lying on a couch. I don't know why it is a close-up. So it is kind of a ride. So there's a cat on the couch on the system. So this is a guy, a little girl in a pink hat is blowing bubbles. I guess it's not really right on anymore on the setting. And here is something that what I like is a refrigerator filled with lots of food and drinks here. And I guess this is a hopeful state. If the computer must have been hungry in looking at that. And here's a yellow school bus parking on the parking lot. I wish we would have this kind of school buses as well, so it would be nice. But perhaps not. So this is the level of what computers can do now. So what deep learning neural networks are able to actually figure out from the image on the setting. And this is now coming from a little, now I'm starting to make it a little more theoretical, so sorry. So what is the kind of a basic of this modern way of doing machine learning is that they are not anymore feature engineering the system, you're actually making the computer to learn. So it's about feature learning on the system. So it's bad for the computer, it's good for the humans because they don't have to know anything anymore. They can just put the system on and give it data. And then I guess these are the kind of the basic ideas that this is a list of what has been able to do in what is the deep learning is best in the world. It's about object labeling, for example. There are some papers you could see. There's a speech recognition paper that just came around, which is actually fully connected. I will which is actually pretty nice doing for wording. And then there's natural language processing. But then there's still the kind of a really question I want to answer here is that why is this system working? So why does it work so well compared to any other machine learning techniques that one has used? And why it is so that you have to have these deep layer networks rather than have a same size of parameters and in a shallow way on the system? So what is the idea around here? So this is the kind of a complicated mathematics, what is in behind. So it has a neural network input layer, then there's a next hidden layer, and there is a next hidden layer, and then there's some classification layers that are coming after it. There is a matrix of weights, how all of these are connected, and it is actually, this is nicely, you can see the color, and it is the corresponding part of the matrix, and then you have a matrix multiplication here, which you do, and then essentially what you get is a bias guy here always, because you don't want to do unbiased things. And this is all. So it's one matrix multiplication. And then it has to have a nonlinearity. And here the nonlinearity is that if you get negative inputs, you just put a zero in. So you use a machine that doesn't have negative numbers. So then that would kind of make it all. One has tried all kinds of nonlinearities in the system. This is a kind of important part of the neural network, because otherwise the layering has no meaning whatsoever, because you can multiply the matrices in. So it needs this non-layer. And the one people are using is this one. So leave the data as it is. If it's positive, make a zero if it's negative. And these are the more biologically inspired models that one has been using. This is the best. In trials, so the simplest one is the most effective on the system. Then when one has this set of neural networks around here, then one can specify it a little. So if there is an image system, what you have is rather than having matrix multiplication here, you are using convolution. So it means that you are not actually using a matrix that is fully free for all weights, but you are actually forcing every band here to have the same number, have a same value for the weight on those guys. It goes band-wise. And this is reducing the amount of parameters in your system a lot. But it also makes it in such a way that when you study the neural network that is produced out of that, it is looking at images so that they are position independent. So it recognizes a cat in the corner as well as in the middle. So this is what it does, and you can take this symmetry into account by using a convolution here rather than you would using a system. And then what it does, this deep layer, it makes this kind of hierarchy of representations. So this is a lower level hierarchy of things. They are essentially this kind of filters that bring out. The next layer is going to a little higher concept level, and then you have an even higher concept level which is going around that in the system, and it is making this hierarchy of representation of the data just by itself. So you are not tuning this in any kind of a way, but the system itself creates this hierarchy when you do it on the type of the thing. A really more concrete, concretely, you have input data, then you have a set of convolutional filters, and they produce this kind of a set of feature maps out of those convolutions. Then you do something which is called pooling, so you don't want to have these big pictures. You essentially do something which is taking, you take three pixels and you take the maximum value of the pixel and put it here. So this is a coarse-grained image of that guy, so nothing else is happening there. Then you do a convolution filter again. You get again a feature map setting on the thing. Then you again do this kind of a pooling. And then perhaps here you already do the linear classifier, and then you figure out what is the result around here. And this is the process. So mathematically, you can actually do it very easily. So in type of a system, the problem is that when you start training it, how do you figure the values for the filters that are in between them here? Again, showing a little about these learning hierarchies. So how this kind of image of the house is coming from the facts that you have the parts that are creating the actual concept. What is nice on that system is it's universal. So in the setting that you can use the same system for images, like here, you have low-level features, you have middle-level features, you have the full kind of, this is a trade for face detection, or you can use it for sound. So this is something which people kind of have spent tens of years in kind of understanding a certain domain, like what is this to do audio speech recognition, what kind of features are good for it, or what is good features for image understanding. You don't need to do that anymore because this is giving them you for free. Almost for free, but there are some things that you have to have in order to make it happen. So now I'm going in the wrong direction, sorry guys. And then there's another type of neural network which is good for time-dependent data. So that kind of data that is coming in time slots. So there's no spatial symmetry anymore, but there's a symmetry that something that is a word yesterday is a word today, and the same word is going to happen on tomorrow as well, and it has the same type of an item. And then one has this deep layer neural network here again. There's a set of spectral graph that you are actually sending as a data in. And then each of these weights on each of this kind of a trap when you go from one hidden layer to the next one is fixed to be the same in every layer. So this is how a recurrent neural network is done. So all the weights are similar on all of these columns. But the difference between the later one is that there is a connection between the past and the future. So this guy has some input for what was the guy, what was the phoneme said before. And it also has the idea that what will be said next. Of course, in real time, in causal system, this is a little hard to figure out how do you know in future what is going to happen. So this system is working so that you tell it the full sentence, and then it starts calculating it from both ends. So what was the kind of a final result, and what was the kind of a first result, and then it brings it together. The red rows are coming from the future, and the blue arrows are coming from the past. And then you fill it out on the system. And then here are some results. So this is just lately come. This is from Baidu Research. Andrew Ng is now working for it, one of these kind of fathers of deep learning systems. And he has a lab in California. And you can see that this kind of a deep speech on this kind of a noisy data has an accuracy, about error rate about 16.5. compared to this kind of a normal system that are going to 19% or something like that. And this is a huge improvement compared to that kind of a system. And the previous models that you were using, this kind of a deep neural network, but they were this kind of hidden marker model, kind of alternations on top of it. Now this is a fully deep solution to that without any Markov models anymore in the system in type of area. So this is the type of output that you get. So there was text, and the first RNN is actually giving what is the weather like in Boston. Boston right now, Prime Minister Narendra Modi are the tickets for the game. So this is the type of a thing. And then they use a language model on top of it to figure out that what is the engram model to figure out the kind of a, that it is, has some vocabulary on it. So it brings it up to the correct answer. On the, so I have been now talking about supervised learning, and one of the things that this neural networks always can do is this unsupervised learning. And there was this Google GLAD what was created. You just give you YouTube videos and you train the system. Every layer is essentially one of these convolutional neural networks, and then at some stage you find a neuron that is activated by a cat. On the, of course, it could be activated by Jennifer Aniston, for example, or somebody else, but on the system. But this time it was about the cat, so whatever producing on the system. So it makes a classification that is totally unsupervised on the thinking. And they were using this kind of autoencoder trick, layer by layer trick, as I was calling in before. In the hand is saying that each layer you try to produce the data with a less data that you have in the between. So how to define the hidden layers. And then you do that for the next layer again and make a tower of the system. And this is the optimization function you are using. So to recap, so what is happening on this deep learning very often, it is that you have this kind of a set of high tower of deep multi-layer network. Then what you do is that you try these autoencoders, you have a data, you have some hidden layer around here, and you want to produce the data again. So this is how you start training this unsupervised system. You train it by itself. And what it does, so every layer you do the training layer-wise, like the cat retina is doing it, and then you finally have a system that can classify things on the top layer. So if you really want to have some kind of idea, so this is perhaps in the setting that if you want to classify something, very often the classification manifold is very complicated. It's this kind of a, it's hard to find a kernel for handling it. And what is this, every layer is doing, they actually straighten up the manifold in a simple way to find out a kind of a shorter, dimensionally reduced representation of the manifold that you can then wrap open, and the final the classification becomes trivial after that. So there is a neuron for that, and there is a neuron for that. That is doing on the. Of course, now when you are looking, so this is now biology inspired, and you're looking at this is what following, and people got it working on that. But later one has found that if one just has enough data and one has enough computer power, you don't have to train these things with autoencoders anymore. So they just, you can train them all. And all these things that people were saying 10 years ago that it doesn't work because it's too difficult, then the answer was that you just didn't have big enough computers and have big enough data. For vision, for example, somebody was saying to me that what you need is one petapixel of data for images in order to actually train the network. So it is something like Flickr gets in a year or a couple of years. It is something that a baby sees in a year on thinking. It is something that wine produces in 30 days. So this is the amount of data that kind of what is required in order to actually have this classification happening on the system. And of course, one of the things that, because this is such a simple, the algorithm is so simple in the setting, is that when Google was doing the Google GLAD, it was using 1,000 servers and 16,000 CPUs, and it was very proud of using their own network for that. Then Andrew Ng was using GPUs and built 3 servers and 4 GPUs to do exactly the same thing. And there's 1 year in between here. So what's the difference of using GPUs, and what is the difference of using CPUs on the? So we have built this kind of system as well, and using the GPUs to make it so, because it's much easier to have this couple of GPU servers around here than the 1,000 servers on your hand. So it suited on the. And the way to what is the actual algorithm that you are using, it is this backpropagation. This is now from Jan LeCun's lecture about what is backpropagation and how you do it. It's essentially figuring out if you have an energy function, and then you have to find out how to tune the weights in such a way that the energy is giving you the loss function is giving you the right result for the training. So you have to change every layer, the weights in every layer, and the idea is done in a backpropagation in a way that you can use the result for calculating the derivative respect to weights around here. You can use it to get the weights here as well. So in the setting, so it is a recursive algorithm that makes your life easier. And but this is still exponentially decaying, so exponentially increasing that kind of a workload when you do it, and it is hard. And part of the problem also is the fact that the information gets lost in the way. So if you have an error signal around here, then how big of the error signal propagates down here, it's also brown with the errors, because you cannot calculate the derivative exactly, the gradient exactly. You have to use something which is called stochastic gradient that you estimate in the stochastic way. So then your information gets lost when you have multiple layers around here. And there are some tricks to actually counteract that in the system, what you're doing on the idea. So then there were some ideas that okay, let's make it even simple. So after the back propagation is that there were some guys looking at okay, so how to actually then transform the information back from the higher layer. And it is not really, the back propagation is not an algorithm that one could think that biology is using. So then what these guys were thinking that okay, let's just make a random matrix that propagates the error back. Nothing to do with the calculation of the gradients or something like that on the system. Just put this B around here. Let's see that, okay. I have an error here, and then I multiply B, and then I give it back to the weights, and I will change those weights accordingly. And then they started making some experiment about the things, and then there's this, what they call feedback alignment idea. So looking at this is the green curve, and back propagation is the black curve. So some funny reason, if you just give the system a little hint about that I'm not happy, it is enough for the network to figure out the correct result. So this error is saying that I'm not happy. And then you change something, and then you do it, it actually most probably goes to the right direction. So this is the kind of about the angle of the direction, where the back propagation gives you the right angle where you should go, the right direction when you do the kind of the gradient descent on your system of many shallows, and this is giving the kind of angle difference of if you just pick a random angle. And most of the time it starts in the stirred, perhaps in the even in a wrong direction, going totally opposite, but then at some stage it actually always goes to about 30% of the right direction. And if you go 30% in the right direction without calculating anything whatsoever or very simple things, it is enough to actually find the minimum, because it's proportional to the error that you actually get. And this is also a very kind of a funny result on what is happening around here. So that this is on. And now, looking at a little deeper on these deep neural networks, I was already talking about this role of symmetries that one is having. For example, the convolution is used for spatial symmetric systems, and recurrency for temporal systems. And this is very much the kind of the same thing that you have physics in. For example, they are always, if you have a symmetry in the system, like something is staying similar in time, then the energy is conserved. If something is staying similar in translation, then the momentum is conserved, and the type of an idea. So there is something that is, the symmetry is actually forcing that your solution to have a certain form, and you can use it quite effectively in understanding what is happening, as we were using. So convolutions we are using for the images, spatial images, and that reduces the number of degrees of freedom in your system quite a lot, and makes it help. And recurrency is the kind of this energy conservation type of an idea. What is not here used is something which is changing a scaling in images. So if you change the scale in the system, then for example, if I look at the audience for this distance, then the audience is exactly the same if I go farther away and I have a smaller picture of the system. So there is a scale invariance in images as well, if you look at that on the type of an idea. And this is very much about something which is, as now coming from a theoretical physics background, I like to talk about this, is coming from renormalization. So which is the idea about that if you do a successive coarse grading in the system, then you can create this kind of an idea about renormalization group, about figuring out what is the basic relevant features of the system when you look at it in different times, different kind of scales of the system. And this is a kind of this coarse grading system that one is using to build essentially everything that we know about physics nowadays on the system. The only problem, so we could have a theory of everything if everything would be acting like that. Gravity is not behaving like that. It is a little ugly, so then we don't have a theory of everything yet. But this is an example about this coarse graining. So if you twist your eyes a little and you look at an image, then you can actually see something else than you could see. If you change the scale, a mobile phone is good for that as well. So if you look at this through a mobile phone screen, you can actually see see beauty and intelligence in the same plot at the same time. So this is how it looks from farther away. So so this is about the coarse grading. So this is an image that is not scale invariant in that type of way, because it looking at the different kind of a size of a kind of a pixel number, then or receptive fields, then you can see the difference on the idea. And the same idea is using physics in very often. So if you have this kind of a spin model like what is having here around a picture about magnetic particles interacting in the system, and some of them have direction up and somebody has direction down in the system, and you start coarse grading it up, then it ends up, for example, this model ends up in the coarse grading as being totally ordered. And then there is this, if you look at the interaction here, there's an effective interaction that is creating that kind of an image and that kind of image and that kind of image, and it gives us this flow of different energy, different kind of ways of Hamiltonians, as they call it, on the system that describes the energy behavior. And the weights here are essentially the ones that are the parameters of the system. And you have a flow of parameters, and that is something which is called the renormalization group. And here what is happening, that it goes to that here it is the t equals to zero system. So there is a fixed point in the system that if you look at further away, this magnetic system looks like it would be at zero temperature. At zero temperature, a fixed point of the system. But if you look at it at another temperature, you look at it exactly at the critical point, then you look at the different scale, it's actually self-similar. It always looks the same at every scale. So this is something where the system is the weights are same at every layer that you are doing it, that you are looking at the idea. So then somebody at that time, they figure out that this system of scaling up looks very much like the deep neural network is doing. So how it actually creates this kind of a universality to the system. And they made this kind of a scale invariance renormalization and looking at what convolutional neural networks are doing. And they were training the system to actually see these spin models and predict what would be the upper scaling. And it automatically figured out the correct format of the renormalization group transformation around here. So what is the deep learning neural network is doing, it is making the effective model at the higher scale of the system. So at higher hierarchy level on the system. It starts from the microscopic model, it goes to a higher and higher kind of a degree of blocking on the system and finds out what is the essence of the system. So whether it is a t equals to zero system, whether it is the fixed point is being totally solid at zero temperature, or whether it is a self-similar system that behaves in the same way at every scale. And this is the way that of course on the way when you go, you can see that the generalization kind of a capability of these deep layer networks is such that it can find out these essential features, these university classes of things that one is looking at, and creating the feature maps of the system. Okay, so this is as deep as I can go in this time, so a time frame on systems. So if you want to know more about this renormalization, you go and read. So it is nice courses, and it really is the fundamental of the physics that and the understanding of the universe we have currently. You should know about it in that type of an aspect. But I promised to show some of the results that we have also done with my friends Akos and Mikko on the system. So this is coming from Mikko on looking on. So if one is looking at satellite image and one is looking at maps, so as Nokia is very much part of the map making today on the system, that we are looking at the maps and we are trying to figure out whether a pixel is a road or not. So here you can see what we are using as a training data, and here is something how kind of a system is looking when even if this is now from the set that this was not, the model was not trained with that data. So, but it actually automatically, you can just compare about how it goes together on the system. And it actually does pretty well. So every pixel here has a little kind of area where it figures out what is my context. And according to that context, it decides on it that, okay, there must be a road here. Even if there would be a tree in the satellite image exactly on top of it. So you see that, then this idea. Sometimes it starts to understand the roads are continuous. for example, that there's no gaps in between, at least most of the times. So we have been playing with buildings as well. So looking at around here, it starts to understand the buildings as well, as you can see. They are some of the roads that we see. We have been looking at the forests. So forests are important for Finland. So then we have also looked at forest in woodlands, and this is a nice picture about, I don't think it is from Finland this time, I guess it's from Belarus. So don't ask me why. So this is a city from San Mateo, California, and we do the same kind of an ideas about where would be the buildings inside of the system. And this is essential. There is no information that we have been giving to the system a priori. So what would be the features that make a road, and what would be the features that making a house? But we are giving it to them that, okay, here is a satellite image, there is a house. Here is a satellite image, there is a road for that piece. So this is all the information, and we are using a kind of a set of layers of couple of layers of deep learning neural network to do that. And this is a convolutional neural network. Okay, perhaps I have even time for some questions. And who can build a CNN now? So a deep learning neural network now. So did you get enough information about that? Come on, everybody can.
So, questions for Leo or comments?
Can you do some forecasting? So, how will things look like in 5 years or 10 years?
So, we are going to have machines that understand natural speech and understand natural environment and have real-time image vision on them. So I don't know what it looks like, whether we are going to have robots roaming on the streets that are killing everybody, so, or whether we are going to have cars that are never going to make accidents. So this is, I guess, decisions that society has to do and should do on the settings. So. Yes. Very good question on settings. So I would say that currently, for example, for a video image or let's say successive images, one can do a classification of surroundings for pedestrians, streets, cars, buildings with an 83 millisecond kind of a speed. So in the setting, if you have a car running, that is quite okay for it already. So and this is done with FPGAs. So the algorithm itself, when you are running, it's very simple. Training it is actually pretty tedious because the amount of data that you need is big, and the amount of parameters that you have is almost a billion, at least hundreds of millions very often on the case. So the number of weights you need in order to actually describe a useful system. Then comes another system about this energy consumption of the device. I don't really know that whether if you would have a human level of intelligence, whether it could run as low power as humans can. So of course the plus part could be on the setting that it's very easy to copy. You make a doctor that has all the information it has and you can use it. But if it uses constantly always, let's say, 100 or 1,000 times more energy than the human doctor would be needed. So I don't know how sustainable that is. But it's easy to copy. So it's easy to train a new doctor when you just make a copy of the system. They are also this kind of nanoscale levels where you start making self-organized networks that would behave a little in the same way. But there the problem is that you cannot write the weights in it. There are billions of weights and you should try to write them kind of a one step at a time, perhaps with AMF machine or something like that. But I don't know whether this is actually practical in the sense you have to grow them and you have to teach them. And in order to really go to this kind of human level kind of power consumption, what I would believe that would happen, that you need to start training them in school as we are training humans as well. So then you don't you don't have the kind of a possibility of copying them anymore as you have with this fully energy. So you have an alternative. Otherwise, you have a fast production of every energy, high energy consuming devices that are not really embedded in the system, or you have something that you have to start training when they are babies, and they become more intelligent. So this could be, I don't know, just guessing.
One question.
Yeah, I like the idea of having computers in the schools as well to learn. Okay, two questions.
More work for teachers.
Why approximately 83 milliseconds? That sounded quite specific.
Because that's the trial that they did.
Okay.
So this is a number in the paper for Georgia Tech.
Second, because kind of what I'm interested in was the next step. If we talk about classification, I guess these neural networks are really quite good at.
Yes.
And so, for example, you said in a couple of years we have computers that understand natural speech. But does it mean that they can classify what we say? Or is there then the next step? Because then
transforming
my speech into text
yes,
is one, and
so,
the second
so
thing is
yes,
actually understand.
A good point again. So there is a difference between a 3-year-old and a 20-year-old. So a 3-year-old can understand almost all the words that you could, or a 7-year, but does it really understand the concepts that are behind is another question. And that requires another type of, this renormalization transformation to a higher layer that starts containing the knowledge of things like what are deeper. But it may be easy to make at least computer programs that look like this kind of Turing test machines, that because they can interact in a natural way with humans on the level. But whether they really would be intelligent to the level that humans are.
That is somewhere there.
Yeah, even somewhere. Perhaps in some specific fields, for example, detection of cancer for images, it could be actually better than humans.
Yes.
On this kind of classification task again. But we never know. So let's see. It's fun to have something to see in the future and wait on the... But new year is coming. Okay.
Yeah. On the same energy issue and... Given your physics background, do you have any faith on the quantum computers?
Oh, quantum computers. Actually, they are pretty nice on doing some of this minimization problems that we would actually encounter with that system. So, how to train the weights? But I don't know if you have trained the weights in outside, then if you try to make an embedded quantum computer, I don't know if you have a capability of carrying a close to T equals to zero temperature device in your pocket. So that, I guess, is the hard part. But if you have this cloud-based system where those devices would be connected to cloud, and then in the cloud you would have this device that can take all the encryption away with those fast computers, then perhaps yes. So on the setting.
Leo, do you think that if we are taking the cross-section and the traffic scenario that you have, every car will have a personal traffic light, means that when you are coming in a cross section.
Yeah, that is exactly what it means. Yes.
And every car shows when you are allowed to move and when you are
yes.
not. And
yes.
It gives the natural flow.
Yeah. And also there is no need for traffic signs either. So why do you need it? Because the machine knows essentially on the roads that what is the sensible thing to do, and you have the etiquette. So there not be any traffic signs around, and there may be also car-based speeding limits on the thing that based on the weather condition and the traffic or something like that, one can always find out the optimum way to travel on the system.
Only this is the old car that doesn't have the protection.
Perhaps they have their own roads that they can still go to. So. Or you can still drive them in the backyard, I don't know. Yes?
No, just maybe a different type of question, but like Stephen Hawking has been like quoted recently and say that this artificial intelligence would be the end of the human race. Should we be worried already, or is it still like a far in the future, like a full of artificial intelligence system?
But I would actually say that there is already a kind of a in totally concrete superhuman intelligence around, and it is multiple people. So quite a lot of the things that are happening in the society are actually not understandable by single person. So we are already in the surroundings when there is this kind of superhuman intelligence around us, and it's a society. And I don't know what is the difference on living in a society compared to living with a more intelligent computer that you would be. So this is my take on it, and actually we have been practicing it for the full time of human kind of a social kind of a history on setting exactly the same situation, how to deal that there's somebody who understands a little more than I do. And I think that there are lots of these things. I'm happy that they are looking at the other angles.
Well, that means that we've had the most intelligent crowd here today, because we're, I think, more numerous than ever before. Mm. And I think that's a very nice way to end this talk. So let's give a big hand to Leo. A very interesting so I just want to wish a very all the best for the end of the year celebrations for everyone, and let's continue these talks then early next year.
Yes. Merry Christmas and Happy New Year.
Yeah. Exactly. Same from me as well. Yes.